Hey there, Oso Mo here, and today's vlog is going to be about data and how I collect data and how I use it in my classroom to better my students' learning and to make sure that I'm giving them things that are great for their process and not so much just like stuff that I want to give them. So here we go. So the first step is assessing your students, and in this process you want to try to find things that are going to pull out exactly what you want to find out on your students. A big thing is that I use our school-wide data. We have school-wide data that we use, so there's specific assessments for that. So I use that, and then there's also something that our county uses called bookworms. I use those assessments as well, which is kind of as a checking all my bases to make sure there's no gaps. I never want my kids to have gaps, especially with kindergarten. I want to build a very strong foundation for them so that when they get to upper grades, they are able to keep those skills versus lose them. So the way that I assess in my classroom is just one-on-one. I pull all of my students one-on-one and do the assessments on them. Some students I can completely just do a whole entire assessment and like go from step to step to step as I progress. Other students I kind of have to do like a little bit here and a little bit there just because their attention spans. But that's just going to be knowing your students and knowing what they need and what's the best way to assess them, because not all students assess the same way. Some students need like certain comforts to assess, some students need certain motivation. So I assess all of my students differently when they're with me one-on-one, just so that I can get accurate data on them. And then I always tell them, you know, give me the best that you can so I can place you in the correct group. The next step is grouping your students. You have to know how you want to group them. For kindergarten, we have, for reading example, we have phonics and phonemic awareness skills that they have to accomplish. So there's about 13 skills that I've got to get to them by the end of the school year. So I try to find kids that have the similar areas of what they need and group those students together. And then after I do that, then I really plan activities that are going to hit that skill. NBI time starts. Luckily for me with reading NBI this year, I had a parent who was willing to come to volunteer, and that parent that volunteered came in 4 days a week. So during our hour-long reading and BDI time, we had four teachers running a total of 12 teacher-led centers. So that kind of let us hit the ground running, and it was a very amazing impact. And on top of doing that, we also had optional differentiated homework. So every child's homework folder looked completely different based off of all the phonics and phonemic skills that they needed. I focused mostly on reading because, I mean, without reading, you can't really do anything else. So that's why with homework at the beginning of the year, I only sent home reading things. The homework folders were pretty massive. I put enough stuff in there. We cycle our centers about 15 days. And so the homework goes for 15 days. So it is a homework folder that the parents have 15 days to work with their child at home on the stuff that's in it. It is not mandatory, but it's optional. The way that I was able to get my kids to really get into it is I paid them with Disney dollars. So for every page that they completed of their homework, like that would be like the front page, the back page, whatever. Whatever page they completed, they would receive a Disney dollar. And in our classroom, we have a lot of things on our Disney dollar menu that they can buy. So that was a very big push when it came to our homework getting accomplished and getting extra practice at home with moms and dads and grandpas and aunts and uncles and grandmas and all that stuff. So as I checked homework folders, I would check them about maybe at least once a week. I would always do like really big celebrations of, okay guys, let's see who's getting Disney dollars. So-and-so is receiving 20 Disney dollars for completing this much homework in their homework folder. In some cycles there was less homework, and other cycles there was more, just depending on what the skills were. And I had my like super go-getters who finished these massive homework folders, and they'd be like, well, they finished it, what should I do? Well, I always had a homework log at the beginning of the folder itself, and that's for just any extra things that they do that's academic, like reading books or Raz Kids or ABC, any kind of technological academic websites. Anytime that they're just doing something academic, even in the car, like playing academic games in the car, I would count that. For every 15 minutes that they did something outside of what was in the folder, they also could receive a Disney dollar. My kids would make bank with Disney dollars. They just would do so much homework all the time to earn Disney dollars so they can buy things. And I think the biggest part of that is that it helped to motivate them. Like now they're self-motivators in which they want to get work done to, I mean, get something. But then it's transitioned into self-motivating, because while sometimes they just want to get it for the Disney dollars, other times we'll be in class and I'll say, okay guys, if you want, you can go on a tablet, or you can go to your book box, or you can go help a friend with their sight words. And most of my kids would rather do their book box or go help a friend with sight words than get on a tablet. So we've got some self-motivated learners. I've got some little leaders. It's been great progress that I've seen. Now, in regards to my math NBI, I didn't really have a parent that could come help in with that, but I did have just me and my para, and we would do our centers. I incorporated around, let's say, December, the use of making differentiated math folders, so that when they were doing centers, I was able to kind of keep up with them as to what they were doing. Like, I didn't like giving them a center but then not knowing how they were doing. I liked having something I could go back to and say, okay, like, you're still not getting this, let's try pushing more from this side. Then another great thing with math that we have been doing, we did school-wide observations where we got to observe other teachers in other classrooms. So in the observations, I went into this one classroom where the teacher was doing math workshop, but she tied it into NBI. So she was teaching that specific skill to her students when they were with her, and then when she released them, they were practicing the skill on their own. And I really loved that, and I thought it was definitely more efficient, because I have a hard time with large group, like whole group teaching. Like, I do it and I feel like there are definitely times for it, but especially you have to know your class. And with the class that I have this year, I have kids that can do whole group teaching, and I have kids that can only function when they're in small groups. So I like to do a lot more of my things small groups, just so that I can reach all of my students. So in a sense, I would be able to teach, if I have a group still working on like counting and comparing numbers, I'm able to kind of work with that group and give them more of like a small group math workshop lesson on that skill. Whereas I could have a group working on word problems, and that I'll give them a math workshop lesson in that small group. And then when they're not with me for the next center, then they are working on it in their differentiated math folder. And then I'm able to go back each time that they do it. I try to check the folders about once or twice a week to really stay in touch with where my students are at. And sometimes my students don't need the whole 15-day cycle. Sometimes they get it within a week and I test them on it. They're doing great, so we move on to something else. I'm just not gonna keep a kid in a group who's successful at something and just hold them back because it's convenient for me. I think with teaching, sometimes we have to always remember that it's not about what's convenient for you, but it's what's convenient for the child, or what's, I'm sorry, not even convenient for the child, but what's best for the child's learning. And that's what I always, that's kind of what I always keep in my head. And there are times when it's like, oh my goodness, you're just doing too much. Well, I'm doing too much because this is what my students need, and I'm gonna push them as far as I can to help them to reach their maximum potential. Okay, so I'll be honest, differentiated folders take me a long time, very long time to do. If you don't have that kind of time, there are many other ways to go about doing differentiated work. I would suggest maybe taking some things, and like I have a website. So if I didn't want to make differentiated folders and spend the money on folders or the time on putting them together and making copies, I could always go and get the resources that I have, and I could email those out to specific parents and say, hey, this is your child's optional homework. Or you could even put it on your class website, which I have a class website that I use all the time. So if I were going to set it up as to have it on my website where I wasn't printing it all out, I would have sections on like maybe a resource page and have them titled like writing numbers, recognizing numbers, greater than, less than, word problems, and so on and so forth. And then I would either like have something that I sent home to parents or something that I would email to parents to say, okay, this is where your child is. If you would go under these topics on the website and work on these things, then that's great. I can honestly say that you definitely want to have your parents on board. You want to have that support from them, because if you have good support from your parents, then that's going to make them be more motivated to help your child or help their child do better in school. Like, they just want to be involved, and I think if you make them really feel important in the process, they're going to want to do more to help you and to help their child in school. One major thing that I do to have support with my parents is I try to build like a really good rapport with them, in the sense that I am constantly talking to them. Like, I'm talking to them all the time. I talk to them through our classroom blog that I have. Also through, I use Remind, which is very easy for me to use. I use email, but Remind is definitely like my number one way to communicate with me, because I can see it on my phone and I can respond to it. Even if I can't respond to it at that moment, I see it. If it's like an emergency, and I can immediately have it there. I also do phone calls. With kindergarten, we don't have progress reports. We just have report cards. So around the time of progress reports, I typically try to do positive phone calls home, where I just call and speak to every single one of my parents and update them on how their child is doing academically and behaviorally in class. I also use these things called data drives. Basically, on Google Drive, I made a Word document for every single one of my students. And in that drive, I have all of our data that we need, that we use school-wide, and it's all put in there so that parents can always see exactly where their child is. I try to update it a good bit so that they can always refer back to it. And then when I do update it, I also inform them that it is updated so they can see what their child needs to work on still. They're able to see the skill, the score that they've received on it, and specifically with letters and sounds, letter sounds, color words, and number words, they can see exactly what their child is missing on those. Now, with the other things, it's school-wide data, so I don't really share copies of that with parents. So those are just a lot of my tricks of the trade when it comes to my data and how I use it and how I collect it, and then how I try to really push my students and get them involved and motivated, get their parents involved and motivated. And this may work for you, it may not. Some of the stuff that I say may work, and there's stuff that I've even talked about in this video that I do or that I did, but I don't really do as much anymore because it wasn't really as effective. For the most part, I do most of the things. The data drives that I use, I still use them, but I don't update them as consistently because I am always talking to my parents anyway. So they just know by looking at the homework folders where their child is. Thank you so much for watching my vlog today. I hope that I was able to help you a little bit with data collection and usage of data. And I will see you in the next video. Have a magical day. No rest, yeah.